All right, so this morning we're going to finish up our series on Truth Over Trend. Over the last month, we've been walking through this series, and we've been looking at some of the trends that have been going on in our culture and our society, and pairing those with the Bible and kind of seeing where they match up and where they don't match up. We've covered the topic of if it feels good, do it, or if it's good for you, if it's right for you, if it's true for you, then it must be all good. And we saw that as simple human beings, most of the time, we are going to make the wrong decision on what is right, and therefore, that's going to go against God and go against the Bible. We covered marriage and gender, and we looked at the biblical plan for marriage of one woman and one man for life and how sex was supposed to be within that union and that union only. We looked at the sanctity of life, and Earl took us through that sacredness. We talked about salvation and how Jesus was the only way, and it was through our faith and confession and repentance and baptism that we can be made right with God in order to have eternal life. And then last week, we looked at mental health and kind of where we've missed the ball through all of that and steps that we need to take to get better. Now this morning we're going to finish up this series with a handful of topics. These were ones that I kind of pulled out and looked at, and I knew I couldn't make a full sermon on any of them. But then again, at the same time, I couldn't make them all fit into one sermon either. So we're going to really have three small sermons this morning. Three topics that really aren't overly related. I don't know how many of you guys have played the game Codenames, which is a really fun game. If you have a chance to play it, you see Walmart buy it. It's a really fun game. But the whole point of the game is you and your team have these words that the clue giver is going to try to get you to guess in as few turns as possible and fewer turns than the other team. But the whole point is trying to get them all to fit together. And I tried to do that with this sermon, but unfortunately it didn't go together. So we're going to break this up and have three separate individual topics, and hopefully it works. And if it doesn't, hey, I'm sorry. So anyway, with this weekend being Memorial Day weekend, we'll start off with the topic of patriotism. In the church. If you go to the website worshiphousemedia.com, which is the website that we get a lot of our media that you see on the screen, the backgrounds, the videos and such, you would see just a whole slew of Memorial Day videos. And I'm sure that all over the nation this morning as churches start their worship services, they have these videos or something like it, and taking time to celebrate in their churches the greatness of America. I'm sure there's some churches this morning that are singing songs like God Bless America or America the Beautiful in their worship sets. Moreover, there may be churches that have American flags on their stage, and they may even start their service by reciting the Pledge of Allegiance. In fact, when we do the VBS thing, the book says that we should start off with the pledge to the U.S. flag and the pledge to the Christian flag every night at VBS. And you may say, what's wrong with that? We should start our services off like that. We should have an American flag on stage. We should have patriotic videos in the church all of the time. But what's wrong, with patriotism? Well, there's nothing wrong with patriotism. There's nothing wrong with loving where you live, where God decided for you to be born and grow up. In fact, I love the United States of America. I love this nation. I love the freedoms that we have. When you watch those videos on TikTok of soldiers coming home, I can't tell you, every time I see one, it just brings a tear to my eye. And Brooke always makes fun of me because I'm such a softy for that kind of stuff. But when it comes to the church, and when it comes to the matters of faith, when it comes to the matters of God and Jesus, our patriotism must take a backseat. A backseat with a divider so far that it doesn't creep in to the time that we set aside to worship our Lord and Savior. You see, there's nothing wrong with patriotism at all. There's nothing wrong with being proud to be in such a great country. We do live in a great country, and it's wonderful the freedom that we have to come here and worship. There are many nations that don't have the opportunity to come and assemble together and worship. But when we bring our patriotism, our love for America into this time, we begin to worship our patriotism, and we begin to worship our country above God. We begin to see God as the God of the United States. We begin to see Jesus as an Uncle Sam type flying the flag. We begin to see the United States as God's new promised land and His new chosen people. We begin to take the truths of God and apply them solely to the United States, and we turn them and revolve them around the United States, and we Americanize Christianity, and then we ship that all over the world, and we send missionaries carrying out the American religion to people so that they can experience the American Jesus. We begin to think that God is for America only. I mean, we have even turned Jesus into a white guy from Kansas City. But the truth of the matter is that this God that we serve and this religion that we follow is a worldly religion. A lot of the times when we bring our patriotism into the church, we are shutting God into one of the many countries throughout the entire world. Jesus came to save the whole world. I mean, Jesus was a Jewish man who lived in the Middle East. I mean, the truth of the matter is that this movement of Christianity is not one that is confined or limited to one nation, be it under God or not. And in fact, if you look at Christianity around the world, the United States is not as the forefront as we are told, as we would expect. Yes, there are more Christians in the United States than any other country, but only 67% of people in the United States claim to know Jesus. Whereas Mexico has 90% of their population as Christians. The Philippines, 93%. Italy, 92%. Honduras, 100%. I don't know how they poll everybody, but Guatemala, 87%. Belgium, 75%. Colombia, 9%. Austria, 81%. Even Russia, 80%. We act like the United States is the promised land, but we're not even in the top 25 of percentages of people that follow Christ. It is a global movement. It is a world wide religion, and Jesus is here for the whole world. More than 600 million Christians live on the continent of Africa. Nearly 400 million Christians live on the continent of Asia. 550 million Christians live in Europe. The highest number of Christians in Europe reside in Russia and Germany. Latin America has 600 million Christians living in it. North America has around 230 million Christians living in it. It's a global family. It is a global family. We see that in the Great Commission when Jesus is talking to his disciples. He is saying, it says, Jesus came to them and says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded to you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Jesus says, go into all of the nations. Go into the entire world. He doesn't say, go to America, give them the gospel. When they figure it out, they're going to mold it to their liking, and then they will spread it. No, that's not what Jesus was saying. But man, that is how we act sometimes in our American churches. Now, don't get me wrong. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying this to bash America. I'm not saying this to bash people who are patriotic. But I want to get the point across that as followers of Christ, we are not American Christians. We are Christians that happen to live in America. We are a part of the family of God. We are children of God, sharing in the inheritance of Christ with people living around the world. In fact, I would say that as followers of Christ, we have more in common with a follower of Christ who is in an underground church in China than we do with someone who lives in the United States who is not a follower of Christ. We are the family of God, and that is where our identity should lie, with Christ, not with our national pride. Look at Paul's words to the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians 12. He says, for just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many are in the body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and we were all made to drink of one spirit. So when Paul says, like, look, when we are in the body of Christ, nothing else matters. Every other qualifier that we have is completely gone. Every other identifier that we have is completely gone. And the only identity that we need to have is that we are in Jesus. Our life and our identity is with Christ, and our citizenship is in heaven. Look at Hebrews 13. He says, for here we have no lasting city. So here on earth, we have no lasting city, but the city that we seek is one that is to come. Through Him, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of the lips that acknowledge His name. So what the writer of Hebrews is saying, he says, look, we don't have a lasting city here. We don't have a place here to hang our hat. We don't have a citizenship here on earth. Instead, what we have is a city in heaven where we will live forever. This is nothing but a temporary place for us to live now. That's exactly what Paul is saying in Philippians 3. He says our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform this lowly body to be like His glorious body by the power that enables Him to subject all things to Himself. Our citizenship is in heaven. We are citizens of heaven. And we are just here waiting for the time to go home. We shouldn't be beating our chest, bleeding red, white, and blue like America is the end-all, be-all. America is good, but God is great. America is good, but heaven will be exponentially greater. One more from Paul, from Colossians 3. He says, set your minds on things that are above, not on the things of this earth. We look to heaven. We look forward to heaven. We follow Jesus with everything that we have. We love this country. Yes, we love the freedom that we have, but we love God and we love Jesus and we follow Him and we look forward to heaven exponentially more. Now, on to trend number two, and another massive trend that we have in our culture and our society that can be very dangerous and very counterintuitive to the Bible, and that is the massive worship that we give to celebrities. And we see this every single day. We see this every single day. We follow their every move. We follow them on social media. We listen to every single song on Spotify. We watch all of their videos on YouTube. We catch all of their highlights on SportsCenter. We spend our money on their merchandise. We go to their concerts. We go to their games. We go to their movies. We read their autobiographies. We watch their documentaries. We try to model our lives after them. And in that, we worship them. And they have massive influence over us. And for all of us, it's a different celebrity. You may be a Swiftie, you may be a Belieber, you may be a Blockhead, a Deadhead, or a Parrothead. You may be the biggest fan of a Hollywood actor, a TV actor, a sports figure, or even a news anchor. But whoever we follow, whoever we spend our time, spend our money, give our devotion to, these people that we don't even know, we promote them to gods in our lives and in our hearts, and that is a dangerous place to put someone. In the Old Testament, God was very clear to the Israelites about them worshiping Him exclusively. So much so that the first two commandments revolve around worshiping other gods. From Exodus 20, he says, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven or above, or that is in the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers and the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to the thousands who love me and keep my commandments. God says, don't have any other gods before me. Make no idols before me. But that's exactly what we do when we place people, mainly celebrities, in an elevated status on our hearts and in our lives. That's exactly what we do when we revolve our lives around these people. This is exactly what we do when we follow these celebrities with everything that we have. I love the way Jonah puts it in Jonah 2. He says, those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love. Jonah says, when you place your hope and your faith and you worship something other than God, you are trading the things. You're trading the steadfast love for vanity, for something that is completely not there and completely worthless. We forsake our hopes of steadfast love because we're trading what God has done for us for what these idols have for us. We have a God that loves us so much that He sent His Son to die for us. In response, we put all of our time and resources and energy and devotion into following something of this life, this temporary world. We are just trading the perfection and the love of God for someone that doesn't even give a hill of beans for us. And honestly, we have no excuse. Look what John says in 1 John 5. He says, and we know that the Son of God has come and given us understanding so that we may know Him who is true. We are in Him who is true. In His Son, Jesus Christ, He is the true and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. John says, look, we know what is true. We know what is good. We know that Jesus has come from God and that he is right there with it. He is the true one. He's given eternal life. So as a result, we need to stay away from idols. Keep yourself from idols. Now, is it simple to listen to music, follow sports, watch TV or movies? No, of course not. Is it simple to follow a celebrity on Instagram or go to a concert? No, of course not. But as followers of Christ, we need to make sure that we are not following anything more than we are following God. We need to make sure that we are putting God above all. We need to make sure that we are worshiping God and God alone, and that He is absolutely, without a doubt, first and foremost in our lives at all times. Now, on to the third and final trend that we're going to look at this morning. And this last trend that we're looking at this morning is the deconstruction of faith as a trend in the United States. This is a trend that's going on in our society and our culture where people are destructing their faith and then reconstructing it in a way that they see fit. Here's a bit of a breakdown of what deconstruction is from Gravity Leadership. Deconstruction is the heading most recently applied to the process of questioning, doubting, and ultimately rejecting certain aspects of Christian faith. This is an application of deconstructionism, an approach that claims to disassemble beliefs or ideas while assuming their meanings are inherently subjective. Both the trend and its title reflect backlash against the unfortunate habit within some religious circles to downplay deep questions and ignore those who hold them. To openly investigate the nuances of belief, even changing one's convictions in a biblical concept. In practice, though, deconstruction is almost always acts of polite cover of demolition. Modern deconstruction usually means replacing uncomfortable tenets with culturally or personally popular ideas. So the dangerous part of that trend right there is that last couple of sentences. This trend of deconstruction is literally taking away the things and the parts of the Bible that we are uncomfortable with, things that we don't like following, things that the society and culture say are wrong, and taking those away and replacing them with things that are a little bit more palatable to society. And we see that in our culture. We see that in churches. We don't want to be seen as closed-minded. We don't want to be seen as bigoted. We don't want to be seen as square. So we change what we believe so that society will say it is good, so that society will be fine with what we're saying. We want to seem inclusive, so we bend God's truth. We want to seem open and welcoming, so we push away what God really wants for us. We want to fit in and make the Bible fit our lives and society, so we change and alter and sweep under the rug the things that make us uncomfortable. And in that, we dilute the truth of God and we move further and further away from what God wants for us. But I mean, this is the trend that's going on in American churches, broken down and rebuilt into something that we deem better. But that flies in the face of God and all of the things that He has said. Look what Isaiah 55 says. It says, "Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He is near, and let the wicked forsake his ways. Let the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that He may have compassion on him, and to our God, for He will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." God says, look, my ways are not your ways. My thoughts are so much higher than your thoughts. He says the unrighteous move away from this. This whole idea of deconstruction of faith and rebuilding it to what we want, to what society wants, to what culture wants, goes directly against what this says here. We want to change the Bible. We want to change the statutes of God. We want to change His will, thinking that we know better, thinking that society knows better, thinking that culture knows better. But God says, you don't know better than me. My way of thinking is completely different from your way of doing things. The way that I think is very different and higher than the way that you think. I love the way God put it in Job, and put Job in his place in the 30th chapter. He says, then the Lord answered Job out of a whirlwind. He said, who is this that darkens counsel, my words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man, and I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were the bases sunk? And who laid the cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and the sons of God shouted for joy. God's telling Job, who are you to even begin to question what I do? Who are you to even think that you have the understanding to come near to me with this puny little mortal stuff? He says, I laid the foundations of the world. I am the one that was there when the stars were hung on that first day. Obviously, Job was nothing compared to God. His knowledge, his understanding was nothing compared to God. And that's exactly where we are when we say we want to deconstruct our faith and deconstruct the things of God and rebuild it the way we want. Now, with that being said, having doubts and questioning things of faith is not bad. It's not simple. It's a good thing. We should always be searching for these things. We should always be trying to gain understanding of something. It doesn't make sense. We should question it and dive down deeper into it. Look at this passage from Acts. You see the heart of this from Acts 17. It says, the brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they got into the Jewish synagogue. Now these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. And they received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. So Luke praises the people in Berea for being willing to examine the scriptures and test what the apostles were preaching. He says, look, they had their doubts. They were questioning this stuff, and they dug deep into the word of God and found out what it was. That's the opposite of deconstructing faith, whereas the scriptures are being discarded to make it say what we want it to say. When we doubt, when we have these doubts, we have these places where our faith doesn't fully add up with the culture, doesn't fully add up with what we think it should be, that's when we draw as close as we can to God and seek after Him and seek His Word and see exactly what He wants. Doubt is okay. Changing the Word of God for our doubts is not okay. I mean, just look at this passage from the prophet of Habakkuk where we see this great amount of questioning, where he tries to figure out what's going on in his world. Oh Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you will not hear me? Or cry to you violence and you will not save? Why do you make me see iniquity? Why do you idly look at wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law is paralyzed and justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous and justice goes forth perverted. I mean, can you imagine saying these words to God, this God who is the God of law and justice, and he is just basically saying, where are you at, God? Habakkuk is in a place where he's crying out to God with his doubts and his struggles, and he's laying them all out. There's nothing simple or anything with saying, hey, God, what's going on? I need you in this moment. There's nothing simple there. Now, if Habakkuk would have said, hey, God, you have completely left me in this place, and the world is going crazy, so therefore I'm going to go crazy with it, then that would be a huge problem. If Habakkuk said, hey, nothing's going to change with you, God, so therefore I'm going to appease the people and change these words that you have given to me to make them feel better so that they won't be so crazy, then there would be a huge problem. Seeing the craziness and crying out to God in that moment with doubts and worry is not sinful. It's all about seeking God and seeking His ways and staying as close to Him and as close to His ways as possible. No matter how we feel, no matter what we think, no matter what society says, no matter what society feels. Look at Paul's words to the church in Corinth in 2 Corinthians 13. He says, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not realize this about yourselves, that Christ Jesus is in you? Unless indeed you fail to meet the test, I hope you will find out that you have not failed. You see, the guidelines and the statutes of God are pretty clear, and it's our job and our duty and a call on us to study those and to dig deep in those and to follow the word and the law of God and not our own hearts and not what our society and our culture thinks. You know, I started out by saying that these three topics really didn't go together, you know, and on their own, they don't go together. These are three, you know, separate sermons, but I think we can make the case that this is really just one sermon that was preached in three different ways. In each and every situation, each and every trend, there has been something that has been put before God. And the first trend, the first topic was patriotism and how sometimes we put all of our faith and our trust in America and the land of liberty. You know, we can put our own, you know, trust in a certain political party, and we take this great country and we set it up as the king of our heart. We set it up as the king above all other kings. And we set God up as the God of the United States. The second topic that we covered was worshiping celebrities as idols, and we put these people up on pedestals, and we focus on them, and sacrifice for them, and we follow them, and we want to model our lives after them, and we put them in the place of God, most of the time unintentionally, but we worship them instead of God. And then this last topic that we talked about was doubt, deconstructing our faith, deconstructing the truth of the Bible, making it what we think it should be. That's taking ourselves and promoting ourselves into the place of God where we live our lives by our own statutes and not God's. Taking ourselves and promoting ourselves up, and we set ourselves up to worship ourselves. In each of these trends, we are replacing God with something or someone. And we're worshiping it or them over Him. In each of these trends, we are making an image and putting it above Him. In each of these trends, we are taking our trust and our reliance and our faith, and we are taking it away from God, and we are putting it on something or someone else. That is a dangerous, dangerous thing. That is a sinful thing. It's modern day idolatry that we are guilty of in one form or another. When we put our trust, we put our faith in anything other than God, that's sinful. Be it a country, be it a political party, be it a celebrity, be it a sports star, or even ourselves. When we come to a point where we are elevating something to the place of God, we are setting ourselves up as opponents of God. We are setting ourselves up as enemies of God. And God must be our number one. God must be our number one. And Jesus must be the one that we follow above all other things. And if there is anything that we put before God, it is simple and it needs to be eradicated and just completely taken out of our lives. God must be our number one above all. Look at Luke 4. It says that Jesus answered him, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." You know, in this life, there are a lot of things that we can serve. There's a lot of things that we can put before God. It could be, I mean, just so many things. We named a few this morning, but it could be so many things. But we, as followers of Christ, have to put Him first in our lives. And as we come to this time of communion, hopefully you've got your cup and your juice, I want to make a point to you that God is the one that we should worship and serve the most, because He is the one that is most worthy of that. And when we think of all these other things that we worship, we think about the other things that we serve, these other things that we focus on, these other things that we put before God. Yes, America is the greatest country in the world. Yes, we have these wonderful freedoms. But compared to what God has done for us, America really hasn't done that much for us. When we think about celebrities or sports stars or, you know, all these people that we follow and we worship and set up as idols, they really haven't done anything for us other than maybe entertain us. But compared to what God has done for us, it's nothing. And then when we think about what we have done for ourselves, I mean, all we have done is led ourselves into rebellion and led ourselves into sin and led ourselves into an isolation from God. But then what we see is God coming back to redeem us. When we think about how God is the one who we need to worship the most, we think of all of the wonderful things that God has done for us. The greatest, obviously, is Jesus going to the cross. In Philippians 2, Paul says this. He says, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself. He took the form of a servant, being born into the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God was highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, all to the glory of God the Father." So when we think about how God is the one who we should worship above all, Jesus is the one that we worship above all, it all leads back to the cross. It all leads back to the fact that we are redeemed. It all leads back to the fact that Jesus took our sins and went to the grave and came out victorious over death and over sin. Nick, will you pray over the bread, please?
Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for all that you are and all that you are. Lord, as we take that to represents the body, allow us to focus on the sacrifice made for us to cover our sins. Lord, we just ask that as we focus on the cross, we think about the mercy and grace that you give us. The love that you give us freely, openly, for us to accept.
Blake, will you bless the juice that represents the blood?
Dear Lord, we're so thankful that you went to the cross that day for us. So thankful for what it means that we have this time of remembrance and our service. Just grateful that we can come to your house as a body of believers this morning, hear the sermon, and just take this time of remembrance. Please watch over us, guide, guard, and direct us. We pray in Jesus' name.
Because of everything that Jesus has done, we worship him. We worship him as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
To the Virgin came the Word from a throne of endless.
Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that we were allowed in your house this morning. I pray that as we leave this place, we go as people living for you, so that when people see us, they see you. We love you. We're yours. We pray that all the glory and the honor goes to you. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a good week.